Books on Tape presents The Commoner by John Burnham Schwartz, read by Janet Song. Author's note. While the histories of certain members of the Japanese imperial family were an inspiration for the story of this novel, the characters, incidents, and conversations described here are the product of my imagination. This narrative is, from first to last, a work of fiction. Part 1. Prologue. When I was a girl, my father told me the story of two whooping cranes who set out to fly across the world together to fulfill their destinies. Over the middle of the largest ocean, they ran into a terrible storm whose high winds battered and separated them. Blinded and disoriented, they lost their way and flew off again, this time in different directions. One headed west, the other east. Both of them eventually found land, though it was not the same land from which they had departed. Many years passed. On different continents, the two cranes grew to old age. Each was the last of her kind. The space around them, where the wide, comforting wings of a friend had once been, was empty. There was no one to understand what it was like to fly off as one thing in the morning and return as another at night, to grow old without a soul to tell one's memories to. Then, one day, the crane in the west decided to go looking for the crane in the east. There was not much time left. Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, the crane in the east decided that she, too, would go in search of her old friend. The two cranes wisely told no one of their plans and received no opinions. They lived mostly in silence as it was. The night before they were to depart, they said prayers asking for direction and made offerings of rice. They left on their final journeys in the same minute. Both of them flew toward the sun, which they remembered perfectly from long ago. In the west, it was dawn. In the east, it was dusk. No one ever saw them land. Chapter 1. In the years before the war, my family lived in Shibuya Ward, in a large house with a walled garden. The sake brewing company that my father, Tsuneyasu Endo, had inherited from his father, grew and prospered under his guidance, making him a respected figure in the business community. My mother's family was older and more distinguished than my father's, a fact that she neither promoted nor attempted to hide. As for me, born in 1934, the year of the dog, I was an only child and wore the proper skirts that my mother laid out for me each morning. I was fond of tennis, history, and calligraphy. There was, I suppose, nothing remarkable about me as a child, save for my father's love, for it was to me that he always told his favorite stories. Of the world beyond our garden walls, I had little awareness. I could not yet read the newspapers, and it was only in my teens that I grew to love the radio. Good girls like me, who spent hours each day following prescriptives meant to establish their unimpeachable credentials, were even more inward than they are today. One might say that my childhood insularity was a form of hereditary protection, in whose shade, like a pale, delicate mushroom, I grew. The economic depression, omnipresent anxiety, and rising nationalism that had infected our nation and others weren't things I spent time worrying about. The military was aligned under the emperor, believing him to be a god worth dying and killing for. In his name, a coup was staged, and in China, a massacre seen to its bloody end, while in his walled and moated palace in the center of our great capital, his majesty remained augustly silent. On these matters, as on so many others of terrible importance, I held no opinions that I can recall, and of course, no one ever asked me to speak my mind. In the first days of spring, Plum blossoms appeared in our garden, perfuming the air, and camellias as red as the furoshiki in which we wrapped our holiday gifts. There were birds, I remember, one in particular, small and yellow with gray and black wings, used to sit and sing on the stone lantern outside my window. When war came in earnest from the far side of the world, the first major food staple to be rationed in Tokyo was rice. After that, miso and shoyu went on the list. Then fish, eggs, tofu, grains of all kinds. Soon everything was rationed, and whatever the size of one's house or the district one happened to be living in, the only way to feed one's family was to enter the black market and see what could be bought there for 5 or 10 times the pre-war price. This was my mother's job, as of course it was for all the women in Tokyo. Men had suddenly become a scarce commodity, if not quite as sought after as rice. It was not uncommon to see a nearly bald soldier on a street corner begging women he didn't know to add to his 1,000-stitch belt. Each new stitch, it was believed, would help prevent him from being hit by a bullet. Monzen Nakacho in Fukagawa District was the most reliable source for black market supplies. My mother and I went there twice a month. The street was always congested with lines of women waiting to buy this or that. They chatted and picked their teeth. Some nursed their babies. The surface distinctions of birth, which only a year or two earlier would have been impenetrable, had by then been all but wiped away by the shortages. My mother, for example, had always been an elegant dresser. But with the war, it would have been unthinkable to continue wearing formal skirts or even traditional kimonos. Monpei, those wide-legged pants, were what women wore, and my mother was no exception. And color? There was only one. National Defense color, the color of uniforms. Along Monzen Nakacho was a bakery famous for its kasutera. When the ovens were going at full strength, the entire neighborhood smelled like warm sponge cake. Outside the shop, the line of customers would start forming early and keep growing until day's end. Family reunions took place in that line, and political discussions, and sometimes probably love affairs. To much of this drama at my age, I was quite oblivious, absorbed in my dreams of kasutera and of the buttered peanuts and deep-fried green peas that the bakery also sold. I wasn't the only one. The old women around me, too, seemed lost in thoughts of food, not love or politics or war, raising their walking sticks and shuffling forward and planting their sticks in the ground again all day long, like herons fishing in a river of silt. Then there came the sad day when the bakery could no longer procure even powdered Shanghai eggs, and there was nothing with which to make the kasutera rise or to give it its deliciously soft but airy texture. The sponge cake loaves that everyone coveted were replaced by whale ham sandwiches. And it is hardly an exaggeration to say that the sound of air raid sirens and even the roar of approaching enemy planes caused but minor distress compared with the fishy, metallic taste of whale ham on the tongue. The smell of freshly baked kasutera, which had sustained us as a people, was suddenly gone from Monzen Nakacho. And from that moment forward, the street gave off the faint, putrid whiff of a marine graveyard. And still the lines outside the bakery did not shrink. So perhaps it wasn't the kasutera after all that had held us together in the street, morning after morning, but the solidarity of the line. Perhaps we had come to depend on one another in ways invisible and outside anything we'd imagined or wished for. I remember a dog in particular, a very foreign and beautiful animal, a borzoi, I believe it was. We would be standing in line outside the bake shop, and sooner or later we'd see him being walked by his owner, the son of a local doctor. The dog was so handsome that seeing him was like seeing a Western movie star, Cary Grant or Montgomery Clift. By comparison, the doctor's son was short, and his eyes were set too close together. He was considerably less glamorous than his pet, and he seemed to know it, which was rather charming. Everyone who waited in line in Monzen Nakacho was acquainted with the dog and looked forward to catching a glimpse of him. There was something about him, something other than his well-bred good looks. I remember one day standing in line with my mother and seeing the doctor's son and his beautiful dog walking not 10 meters distant, when suddenly, and for no apparent reason, the animal began to howl and moan.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.